All right, so as Helen said, we're gonna zoom out a little bit.
Oh, okay, stand it.
So we're gonna zoom out a little bit and tell you a little bit about where we're headed at the Hughes Lab in Hawaii. So what's really exciting about this project to me, I'm the project manager that's brought together both teams from HIMB and Ames for this big collaborative project and kind of keep us in line and kind of keep that big overview and make sure we're doing benchmarks and meeting with our funders and all of that. So what's everyone recognizes this problem worldwide with coral bleaching, but our project really was hopeful. So we heard about ocean optimism a few times today, it was mentioned. So our hope was in these places, these corals that were not bleaching, and then also can we engineer or just kind of help corals adapt to become even more resilient. So our solutions were really this biological toolkit that we've been talking about today. And with these solutions, these were all a proof of concept as you've heard throughout the day. But our end goal has always been implementation. So we've been working on this project for 4 years now. And we're ready to start planning for implementation, and that's what we're, Carlo and I are going to talk to you about. So one of these ideas for implementation, Ty just presented about Biosphere 2. As he mentioned, this is in the middle of the desert. There's no ocean around, so I think he said Franken reef. You could be a mad scientist there, and hopefully no one would care too much. So we do want to continue looking at engineering corals and make sure, we heard a lot, we had a workshop the last 2 days with our group before this. We heard a lot about people still wanting to look at trade-offs. When you are looking at kind of thermal tolerance, are there other trade-offs that the corals are then lacking? Also, with those trade-offs, is anything happening with multiple generations? So we haven't had enough time to look at all the different generations to see how what we're doing would impact those future conditions. So we want to make sure that all of these techniques are low risk and also cost effective, and whether they would actually improve reef prognosis. So something else that came up, even though it's not necessarily engineering corals, and you've seen these kind of paired bleach, non-bleach corals throughout the day, as Katie mentioned, like this number 39 now looks exactly like number 40, so the only way we can tell them apart are these tags. But what we have in Kanyonga Bay, because of doing this tagging effort, is a living library. So we can go back to these corals and know which ones were more resistant to that temperature stress, more resistant to bleaching. If we go to a new site, which is what I'm really excited about with this project, because we tend to focus too much in Kanyonga Bay, because we are on a, I think it's a 28-acre island in the middle of it, and we have boats and it's easy access. That's something that was beneficial from our end, whereas you guys have the system here. So we definitely love getting out in the field there, but our corals might be behaving differently there than other places in the state of Hawaii or even on the same island. So if we go to a new site, what we can do is stress test these corals, and we've seen that they behave similarly by genotype. So you can tell which genotypes are stronger or more resistant to that heat stress and which ones are more susceptible to bleaching. So our idea with this is to do selective propagation in restoration. So this is an example of why restoration is already needed in Hawaii. So for example, NOAA is mandated to mitigate for large ship groundings. This is an example of a small 35-foot sailboat that just rammed into a patch of reef right in front of a boat full of coral biologists. What are the chances, right? Unfortunately, it happens all the time. So we went and we looked at that damage, and this is the same reef, and just within a couple hours of sitting on that reef and rocking back and forth, just huge destruction. So if we're already going to be doing restoration, then we might as well be enhancing those corals that we put out for future success. So if you spend all this time and energy doing restoration and then a warming event comes in like it did in 2014 and 15 in Hawaii, then and then that just bleaches off your corals, and if they die, then really you did a lot of effort for nothing. So might as well restore for these more resilient corals so they have a better chance to survive in the future, and then you increase your return on investment. So this is really important because we live in an island state, and our reefs are incredibly important in actually protecting our land. So most of us, if we're lucky, live right by the water. And as you can see, this is just about 1 meter foot scenario of an inundation from like a hurricane or sea level rise. And as you can see, there's huge potential economic loss. This is Waikiki down here, which is pictured here. This is our airport. All of our roads are right around the edges here. Luckily, we wouldn't have crocodiles in our streets, like your flooding that you had here. We'll turn around my head around. But it would be a huge economic loss and have great impact. So with that, and especially what we really wanted to do with this project was to be able to take action. And we can do that. We now have partnered with our federal agency, NOAA, our state, which actually controls our waters in Hawaii, which is the Department of Aquatic Resources, and also a nonprofit. I'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. But what we're going to do is all come together so that we, as I said before, the federal and state agencies are mandated to do a lot of this restoration work, but they wanted to bring in the science component of these resilient corals. So we will be working in Oahu at these three sites that Carlo will talk about a little bit later. But I did want to mention that NOAA has also recently pushed for us to include U.S.-affiliated islands in the Pacific. So the idea now is that we are going to provide advice for them, and we're going to try to kind of run these experiments in parallel, which now we have experience doing with Australia. We'll now look at those islands as well. For me, being a project manager, the most exciting part of this is that we're making a community effort. We're a single lab. NOAA and DAR don't really have a ton of resources for this. Our government didn't invest as much as your government recently did. So in order for us to be able to make a real impact with restoration, we have to look at these community groups. So this is just an example from Lama Manalua, the group that we are working with. They do invasive algal removal projects pretty frequently. And especially with a big part of our project has been to communicate about assisted evolution. And chasing coral was one of the results of that. I get contacted all the time about chasing coral and with people saying, how can I help? And this is one way that people can actually help. So that's the direction that we're going in Hawaii, but now I'm going to bring up Carlo so that he can tell you more about how we're going to investigate what these resilient corals actually do enhance restoration efforts, which is our first question.
Thank you, Kira. Thank you, everybody, for staying. We've had a little bit of attrition since the morning, but we're the resilient ones. We're still here. If we were a rural community, then we'd still be holding together. A little bit over that time, but I think we're ahead.
So we can go a few minutes.
Thank you. Because I'm going to explain sort of the conceptual framework and some of the details of the project that we're setting up to do. So there's a lot of evidence that heat tolerance in corals is a complex quantitative trait. We've seen some of that evidence today. And that suggests that there would be adaptive potential in coral populations to adjust to changes in temperature in the future. And so corals are going to face 2 degrees or possibly more, depending on how humans behave, over a single Did I just say wrong? Pardon?
It does that sometimes.
It just does that sometimes. If you blink of an eye, everything just like vanishes and like the clothes are gone. That's a point against me. Sorry, I got a little distracted there. What I was trying to say is, corals are going to face the stress of a couple of degrees over a single century. However, there have been population modeling and scenarios run that show that even within some of those climate change scenarios, that populations will persist because individuals will emerge that are better adapted for those future conditions. And while that's great news for those individual corals, it may not be good news for the coral reef, because as we talked about today, the demography of corals is not really in sync with a 100-year time window, given the time it takes for corals to become reproductive and the frequency at which they can populate. And so for climate, for coral cover, that's a problem. If you contrast that with if the selective pressure was stretched out over a much longer time frame, say for many thousands of years, in that case, there would be time for all those emergent corals to basically fill the gaps in the population. So not only would the population persist, but the integrity of the reef would be kept the entire way through. And that is sort of one of the goals of restoration, is to stitch together those gaps in reefs, because for the ecosystem services that we're interested in, it's not just the persistent population, it's the actual physical integrity that's breaking up wave energy, that's providing food production and other economic interests that are vital to people. And so reef restoration practitioners use the same tricks that we do as researchers or that are used in the hobby, which is asexual propagation of the corals to make larger numbers from a single genotype, and that can be iterative so that you can produce like huge numbers of coral stock from a single genotype. And then those could be outplanted onto the reef as here, but one of the major things that's been understood in reef restoration practice is that, as Kira was saying, you don't want to plant something here if there was a stressor in place that kills off coral if you don't mitigate that stressor. So if you can keep ships out of the area, ship grounding was the issue, you do that. Climate change presents a special problem because you can't mitigate it at the local level. If we were all resource managers, what we want to do would be to go visit our future reef. So we would go forward a few decades, we would look around, we would go, oh, some bleaching events have occurred in the intervening decades, it's now an algal-dominated wasteland. But here and there, we find a few corals that are holding on, those more resilient types. And so we would take that knowledge and we would return back to the present day, and we would make sure that the corals that we planted were derived from the genotypes that we knew for sure were going to persist, so we don't waste effort. We can't look into the future in our lab yet, I mean, as advanced as we are. So we were going to use our best guess as to what the more resilient corals would be in the future by using artificial stress tests in a purpose-built facility that's been installed at HIMB. And in some cases, we do have prior knowledge of how a source colony performed during a natural bleaching event. So that's cool. We're tangentially also interested in proxy metrics like spectral profiling or genetic markers, because if those are predictive of temperature tolerance, then that's much more tractable for a resource manager to apply over a big population than trying to screen the population and then run it through like an artificial stress test. So for our workflow, we have corals opportunity that have been gathered by NOAA and other agencies and ourselves in the field. We'll subsample those, apply heat stress tests to them to assess heat tolerance, propagate them with an emphasis on those that are at sort of the higher end of that distribution. And that can be an iterative process to our onshore flow through tanks. We'll be housing those and recovering them before they return to the field to be held for outplanting. So when it comes time for outplanting, Kira mentioned we have three sites around Oahu. We're working with partners. Each of those has an area that will be designated for restoration work. And inside that area, we will survey and make identical sized plots. And each of those will be randomly assigned to one of three treatments. So it's very simple. We have plots where we do absolutely nothing, plots where we do traditional restoration, where we just take whatever corals we have and we plant them, and then our experimental plots where we purposely skew the population to that higher performing end of the curve. And that's really the heart of the experiment. So these plots are our experimental units. We compare a unit to our number of colonies that are alive, fish abundance, richness, and these kinds of things to see how they perform. And so as Kira said, we do have three sites. We're going to do that plot method that I mentioned at all three sites pretty much the same way. There are some areas of focus that we differ at each site, and I won't go into that detail now for just of time. But in the third site, it is very community driven. There are people living at the bay that want coral back on their reef. And so that's really exciting to me. The whole project is exciting to me because it bridges sort of the research and implementation, as well as having this like community, like grassroots effort. It puts all that together in a way that I think is really fitting, because this may be the last big project that the Gates Coral Lab does as an entity. And Ruth often advocated for that kind of like, get out there and let's do something. And I think that her advocacy for that has given us, you know, a platform. It's given us standing, and it's given us courage to like go ahead and try a project like this. So we're really excited about it. And of course, it couldn't happen without all of these funders and lots of helpers that aren't mentioned here. Thank you.